started something good. And happy Sunday morning to each and every one of you. It is time for the First Baptist Church of Tarentum's Sunday morning worship service. And as always, we are so, so very pleased to be with you, to have this opportunity to worship God as a corporate body. And certainly, we are inviting the Holy Spirit in, inviting His presence, His touch, His move, that all that happens through this service would be pleasing in His sight. And we just thank Him in advance for the great things that are going to occur in this service and through this service. Let's begin with our inspirational scripture for the morning. And this morning's scripture comes from the 150th number of Psalm. And it reads, "Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty firmament. Praise Him for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with trumpet sound. Praise Him with lute and harp. Praise Him with tambourine and dance. Praise Him with string and pipe. Praise Him with clanging cymbals. Praise Him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord." Amen. Amen. This scripture is such a blessing for each and every one of us this morning, because it is just a reminder that we ought praise God. We ought be lifting Him up and praising Him each and every day, because He is so, so very worthy of our praise. And He's done so much for us. We just need to keep in mind to lift Him up and praise Him as often as we can. And please know that no matter how things may seem in our lives, we are just so blessed of God, blessed each and every day. Even to have woken up this morning, it is indeed a blessing. So thank you for sharing with me in this inspirational scripture. And now we welcome you, each and every one of you. We don't take you for granted, and we appreciate you taking the time to worship with us. We thank you for including First Baptist Tarentum on your list of services to watch during this time of booming virtual services. There are services all over the country and all over the world, but you saw fit to stop for a moment and be with us. And so we welcome you, letting you know how much we appreciate you. We ask that whatever social media platform you may be watching this particular worship service, that you would hit your like button or your share button so that others will have an opportunity to view these worship services and prayerfully be blessed through the word of God. Amen and amen. We do have a few announcements on this morning. Our first announcement is that we need to get out and vote. November 3rd is election day. And so we certainly issue a reminder for each and every one of us to vote. Whether it's through vote by mail absentee, whether it's through early voting at our local polling places, whether it's going over to our county election office, or whether it's voting in person on Tuesday, November 3rd. Certainly, We encourage each and every one of us to exercise our right as citizens of the United States of America to indeed vote in this important election. We also want to let each and every one of you know that First Baptist Church of Tarentum will be starting or restarting our in-person worship services first Sunday in November, which is November 1st at 10:30 a.m. We certainly invite you all to come and to participate in our in-person worship service. Please know that masks and social distancing is required. So let me just say that again. Masks and social distancing is required. We also want to announce that on Monday, October 26th, we will have Christian Ed Board meeting. That meeting will take place at 7 o'clock p.m. via our telephone conferencing system. Those of you on that board should already know how to get into that system. But if you have any questions, certainly you can reach out to me and I will do my very best to get that information to you well before 7 o'clock. Finally, the Brocks would just like to issue a thank you, an overwhelming thank you to each and every one of you, especially those at First Baptist Tarentum, for your love and your kindness. We have just been overwhelmed with who you are for all of the cards and all of the prayers and well wishes during this trying time in our lives, but also due to Pastor's Appreciation Month. We are just so excited and just so thankful for your kindness. Certainly the gifts have been utilized and we thank you for that. We also would like to let you know that you all did such a great job with the flowers and the edible arrangement. I love fresh flowers and I'm allergic to melon, so it's limited which kinds of edible arrangements I can have, and you all picked the right one. So whoever made the phone call and whoever actually made the order, job well done. Dennis and I truly, truly enjoyed the chocolate covered strawberries. So thank you so much. And now it is time for us to move forward in our worship service, and we will hear selections from our praise band.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my heart. You would lay down your life. That I would be set. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Sing praise,
This morning's message comes from James, the third chapter, verses 13 through 18. That's James, the third chapter, verses 13 through 18. And it reads, "Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace." Amen for the reading and the hearing of God's word. Let us pray. Oh Lord, you are our strength and you are our Redeemer. There is none like you in all the earth. And we are just so grateful for who you are and who we are in you. Heavenly Father, right now we come before you, Lord, carrying this word that you have birthed into my spirit all week long. And Heavenly Father, our prayer is that this word would have an effect on these, your people, that it would grow them and change them. Heavenly Father, make them anew in you. Oh, that Heavenly Father, your power would be felt through this word, that it would touch each and every person who's hearing this message, Lord, that there would be a transformation in their lives. And oh Lord, we pray that this word would be fitly spoken for whatever situation the individuals hearing this message may be going through, that it would touch them right where they are, and that it would be a blessing unto them the way it has already been a blessing unto me. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. 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 Now, just allow me before we get into the message to just say, because I forgot, that when we begin our in-person worship services November 1st, we will also continue to have virtual services. Those virtual services will continue to be posted every Sunday morning. So those of you who make the decision not to participate in person due to COVID-19, we understand, and yet and still we appreciate you and do not want you to be left behind. So these messages will continue to be available to you. Amen. Amen. So the subject of this morning's message is wisdom from above. Wisdom from above. In our lives, we encounter some really smart people. They know so much information and can speak intelligently about so many things. And they make decisions that seem to enhance our lives. And I must admit, the higher the person's socioeconomic status, the more intelligent they seem to be. For the most part, these individuals have attended the best schools. They have embraced higher education. They have obtained executive level positions, and they have invested well. Yes, these are some really smart people. But as we take a closer look at ourselves and others, we find that there is a stark difference between a person that is just intelligent or smart and a person that is wise and intelligent. And it's pretty easy to see. It's the person's character that determines their level of wisdom, not their accomplishments. Let me say that again. It's the person's character that determines their level of wisdom, not their accomplishments. So let's pay close attention, first and foremost, to ourselves. Are we wise and intelligent? The goal of today and this message is for us to take a look in the mirror. Because although the Bible doesn't make mention of what goes on in the lives of others all the time, and from time to time, it certainly does. But the Bible, if we take a closer look at it, is primarily concerned with what we do and what goes on in our lives. For example, Matthew, the 7th chapter in the 1st verse says, "Do not judge so that you may not be judged." That text began with our treatment of others. Do not judge. But it ended on how we will ultimately be treated so that you may not be judged. We see this same dichotomy in today's text. Yes, we are given the tools to identify whether a person is truly wise, but in the end, we are to assess ourselves to determine whether we are living lives of wisdom. Having wisdom begins with merely having an understanding of whether we are wise or not. There are many that truly believe that they are wise, but who in fact lack true wisdom. And then an understanding of what wisdom is, how we can make a determination of what's wise and what's not when we truly don't understand the definition of wisdom is beyond me. And then we have to have an understanding of where we fit on the wisdom spectrum, a true and real self-assessment. And we have to do this for ourselves because no one knows us like we do. Yes, that's where true wisdom begins. I believe that as we look at ourselves, we find that sometimes we are wise and then other times we are not. And that's okay because not one of us is perfect. And as long as we live on this earth, we are to always be striving to do better, live better, and make better choices and decisions. We are to always be working to perfect wisdom in our lives. James here begins with how we generally know if we are wise. Nothing too specific. Just that we know why we are deemed wise. It is, ladies and gentlemen, according to this text, because of how we live our lives. Are we living a good life? Are the actions that we take done with gentleness that come from wisdom? In other words, are we humble? Yes, humility is a sign of whether we are indeed wise. But James quickly moves from general to specific. The problem most of us have is that we gauge whether we are living a good life by what we see in this world, or whether we are humble by our own standards. Such self-serving measures will not aid us in finding true wisdom. Instead, we must begin with our heart's condition. Our wisdom is false if we have bitter envy and selfish ambition in our hearts. We talked about this a little this past week in Bible class. Bitter envy is when we have hostile resentment towards someone else because we perceive them as possessing advantages that we don't have and that we want. The fact that this resentment is hostile makes it so much more dangerous. Assuredly, our hostility may lead to our acting in a way that would harm the person. Please see that when we have bitter envy, we are liable to do anything. And then selfish ambition. We will do whatever it takes to get ahead. It doesn't matter how many people we hurt. It doesn't matter how anyone else feels about it. It's all about us, how we feel, and what we believe will advance our position or status in life. Please see that having selfish ambition will cause us to discount others. They mean nothing to us. And as proof, we treat them as the lowlife that we think they are. Please see the dangers of self-ambition. Making matters worse, when our hearts are in such poor condition, we have the audacity to brag about it. We take pride in our cruelty. We count it as doing what's necessary to move ahead. We see those that we trample upon as being weak and not worthy of respect or compassion. And we are false to the truth. The truth being that anything that we have accomplished is not due to our efforts or strength, but because God either deemed it so or allowed it to be. Yes, a sign of false wisdom is a poor heart condition. And we have to understand that God is not in such a heart. Bitter envy and selfish ambition are not godly characteristics and certainly do not come from above. I think we know that deep down on the inside, but we often overlook this when we teeter on the fence of envy and ambition. And the reason we teeter at all is because God isn't in it. First, this heart condition is earthly. It's based on what we're exposed to every day, what we see occurring around us, what is modeled before us. And unfortunately, we live in an era where having a heart in poor condition has been normalized. We see it so often that we barely even notice it anymore. That's why it's so important that we measure ourselves. We cannot control what others do, but we can control what we do, how we act. And just because certain behaviors are considered normal in this world does not mean that they pass the poor heart test. In addition to being earthly, this heart condition is unspiritual. Galatians, the 5th chapter, verses 22 through 23 tells us of the fruit of the Spirit. If our thoughts and actions do not fit within one of the fruit categories, then we know we are off the mark. Because the Holy Spirit just will not allow us to maintain a poor heart. If we are listening to Him at all, we will make a change, action by action. A poor heart condition is also devilish. I know that none of us good Christians like to believe that we are under the devil's control. But when we have poor hearts, we are indeed under his control. In this case, our actions are no different from the devil's actions. Let me round this out by saying that there is no justification for a poor heart. We far too often justify what we think, how we feel, and how we behave. There is no godly reason for us to have a poor heart. To think of ourselves or to think of anything otherwise is false wisdom. And this false wisdom consisting of envy and selfish ambition in our hearts will result in evil. And conflict will erupt like an unpredictable volcano. I know it wasn't our intention, but because we are living with false wisdom, there is no limit to what we would do in order to get what someone else has, or to promote our own status, whether financial or in prestige. But know that there is a wisdom that is from above, true wisdom. James offers us three attributes of true wisdom. First, true wisdom is pure. It is clean, clean in thought, clean in word, clean in actions. And because of the purity within us, praise is what comes from our mouths instead of words of hate, hurt, and damnation. Yes, true wisdom is pure. In addition, true wisdom is peaceable, meaning that a wise person is peace-loving. Loving peace so much that he or she will take whatever actions are necessary in order to maintain peace without sacrificing purity. This person will walk away from a political conversation that is quickly escalating to being an argument versus taking a stand and pushing their opinion in spite of the disintegration of peace. Peace that is falling apart and into pieces with each spoken word. And the third attribute James gives us of true wisdom is gentleness. True wisdom is gentle. This wisdom is courteous and considerate towards others, and not crude, demeaning, or disrespectful. And being considerate of others is putting their needs, feelings, and desires before our own. Just to be thoughtful towards others, that's true wisdom. Pure, peaceable, gentle. Please see how these attributes are closely related and often overlap. We can't act under one without naturally also acting under the others. We need to pray for more purity in our thoughts, for peace in our hearts, and for gentleness in our actions. Because the more of these attributes we possess, the greater the manifestation will be in our lives. Now, when we say manifestation, we are saying that the results of our true wisdom will appear in our everyday lives. Being pure, having peace, and being gentle definitely affect our character. Yes, the manifestation of these attributes causes us to be willing to yield. Willing to listen and be open to reason, being approachable and ready to give in when truth requires it. In addition to being willing to yield, true wisdom also causes us to be full of mercy and good fruits. Mercy, being willing to help those that are in need. Forgiving others' shortcomings while being anxious to help them find their way. Oh, and our good fruit, it should be seen in the help that we provide. Yes, when we have true wisdom, we will be full of mercy for others, and good fruits will be evident in our lives. There will also be no trace of partiality or hypocrisy in the life of a truly wise person. True wisdom will not allow us to play favorites. We certainly will not prefer one group over another, whether based on gender, age, race, disability, religious beliefs, or political affiliation. And because we have no favorites, we do not treat people differently because of their group. To do so makes us Christians no better than those in the world. And I think this perception is partly destroying the Christian church and faith system. As for hypocrisy, true wisdom will cause us to be sincere and genuine in all that we say and do. never pretending for the sake of appearances. But like anything else in life, becoming a truly wise person is a process. It's not going to just happen overnight. James uses a familiar gardening analogy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. The unmentioned farmer is us. Those that are truly wise, those that are pure, those that are peace-loving, those that are gentle. Yes, it's us. We are the farmers. And when we sow in peace, when we plant in peace, when we live in peace, when we talk in peace, we will reap a harvest of righteousness. Please notice that the atmosphere within which we plant is important. The sowing must take place under peaceful conditions, and it must be done by those who are of a peaceful disposition. Indeed, what is going on in our lives does affect our relationship with God. Peace must abide. At least if we desire true wisdom and to reap a harvest of righteousness. Ultimately, because of what we plant, we will live a life that is upright before God. A harvest will be produced in our lives, in the lives of those close to us, and in the lives of all those to whom we minister. True wisdom definitely brings a harvest that will bless all. But we need to check our heart condition. I found a list of questions that I thought would be helpful. In our checking our heart condition, we must ask ourselves, do I respect the proud men and women of the world more than the humble believer in Jesus? Do I serve the Lord without caring who gets the credit? Do I sometimes use questionable means in order to get good results? Am I guilty of flattery in order to influence people? Do I harbor jealousy and resentment in my heart? Do I resort to sarcasm and unkind remarks? Am I pure in thought, in speech, in morals? Today, let's take a look at ourselves in the mirror and pray, ladies and gentlemen, pray for wisdom from above. Amen. We now take a moment to offer Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior for any who may not know him. Because in order for us to receive this wisdom from above, we have to have a relationship with God. We have to be able to hear from him, and he has to be able to speak to us. And one of the ways that we make that happen is by becoming a part of the body of Christ, joining his family, that he might be able to be our Savior, our Lord, our King, our Master, the one who speaks to the Father on our behalf. Yes, Jesus, I know we've all heard the name before, but we need to do more than just hear about him. We need to allow him to take over our lives. We need to accept him. And if never before today, any of you have not accepted him, now is your time. And all we ask, and all that is required, is that you would believe in your heart that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died a horrific death, and that 3 days later he rose again. Certainly, for any of you that may have questions about Jesus and who he is, we ask that you would reach out to First Baptist Church of Tarentum, and certainly we will take the time to encourage you in Christ. And for those who may be members of First Baptist Tarentum, attendees, or even friends, but who have strayed away, we welcome you back. And we offer First Baptist Tarentum to each and every one of you. And then for those who may be saved, but just not have a church home, we offer First Baptist Church of Tarentum, Pennsylvania as a church home for you. No matter where you are in the country or in the world, we are open to receiving you, to ministering to you, and to certainly being a help to you as you and us attempt to make it through this life, this world, this country where Satan seems to be running rampant. We need each and every one of you to know that First Baptist Tarentum cares. Oh yes, First Baptist Tarentum cares. Please text us for more information at FBTACares@80123. That's FBTACares@80123. Oh, we look forward to hearing from each and every one of you in the very, very near future. We will now hear our closing selection.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and let us sing. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with suffering. Oh, praise Him, oh praise Him, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Let all things their Creator bless, and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him. Washed by His blood, come and rejoice in His great love. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Christ has defeated every sin. Cast all your burdens now on Him. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. He shall return in power and grace. Heaven and earth will join to say, oh, praise Him, alleluia. Then who shall fall and bend the knee? All creatures of our God and King. Oh, praise Him. him. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Alleluia. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Oh, praise him, God and three in King. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
And now for our benediction. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for blessing us with wisdom from above. We pray right now, Heavenly Father, for more purity, for more peace, for more gentleness in our lives, that we might possess the true wisdom that only comes through you. Oh, Heavenly Father, as we leave this worship service, our prayer is that you would go with us. Our prayer is that your face would shine upon us. Oh, that you would give us peace. And oh, that we would be blessed with the many, many blessings from on high. Protect us, keep us, cover us, prevent us from stumbling and falling, and bring us safely back together again. In the precious name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen.